Okay, so I have the distinct pleasure of introducing Dr. Andrea Oliver. She is the cardiothoracic surgery fellow here at Vanderbilt. She did her training at the Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston and Medical School at Boston University. And she does a lot of things in the chest. And as you probably know, things in the chest are complicated and can be difficult. And sometimes you don't always understand what the surgeon does. But hopefully she can dispel some of those myths. Some of you have already had surgery, so this will be a kind of a review for you. But some of you are facing surgery and want to understand what surgery is, I think it would be a really good opportunity. So I would introduce Dr. Oliver.
Simple, and if you look in your handbook, there are no pictures. And the reason why I have no pictures in there is because I just want you to listen. The most important thing that you're going to walk away from your experience, whether it's a family member or yourself as a patient, is that the most important pictures are your own. You can see pictures on the internet, you can see other people's pictures, and everybody has a different level of squeamishness. We're talking about surgery. And so I'm not going to show you YouTube videos of surgery or gross surgery, because it's not necessary. What I want you guys to understand is just the overarching, what we think about as surgeons as part of your team, and also how we try to explain things to patients if maybe you haven't had a chance to have that discussion with your surgeon. But we'll kind of go over this in the way that I would approach it if I were a patient, meaning let's start with from the outside in. What do I see on the skin? And work backwards to the anatomy so that you can understand where things are located, maybe some of the catchphrases that your surgeon will use when you have your discussion. So when you walk into the surgeon's office, one of the first things that we're going to talk about are your preoperative testing. So you've already been diagnosed with a lesion. You've already had your discussion with your pulmonologist or with your medical oncologist. And we'll review your imaging studies. It may be something as simple as a chest x-ray or a chest CT. We've had a wonderful discussion about nuclear imaging studies, which are part of what we review, whether it be an octreotide scan or a PET CT to help us localize where the lesion is. But for us as surgeons, we understand that the imaging studies are a roadmap, but they never give us one-to-one for your anatomy inside. And that will actually play throughout this entire talk. A lot of people think of us as mechanics. I wish that everybody's body came with a manual, but it doesn't. And it's more like being a tailor. We have to kind of tailor it to what we find, knowing that there are some roadmaps that we have given from the imaging studies, but we have to do what's best for the patient in real time as we're doing surgery. The next thing that we talk about and we review, sometimes you all will come to us and they have not yet been done or partially have been done, which is pulmonary function tests. Everybody has a different history. Some people have smoked in the past, some people haven't. Some people have had other medical conditions or perhaps other diagnoses that affected the way that their lungs function. And we like to get an assessment before we even touch you, exactly how well you breathe, how well your lungs function in terms of doing their job, which is just gas exchange. And we need to know that before we start removing sections of lung or manipulating your airways so that we know how you will do during the surgery and afterwards. Those pulmonary function tests can include what we call spirometry. I'm not going to show you the flow volume curves. It's complicated, but basically it tells us how well you're able to move air in and out of your airways, as well as what's called a diffusion study, which lets us know how well you exchange gas across the membrane of your lung. Those are the two major pulmonary function studies. In some patients, it's helpful to get what we call a ventilation perfusion scan, which tells us how well your lungs see blood on one side versus another, and how well that matches to the amount of gas that you exchange in different regions of your lung. It looks a lot like the octreotide scan. It just looks like, it looks like somebody just put an ink blot up there, so I didn't show you a picture of it because it's almost not interpretable, even by us. But the ventilation perfusion scan can help us when it talks about percentages, and we can do basically split studies. If we're concerned because someone's pulmonary function tests have shown us that they have marginal function, it can let us know maybe how difficult or rocky your recovery course will be after you resect. And sometimes it can actually help us decide how much is safe to resect. Meaning, if you take any more lung, you probably will have breathlessness or you'll have real challenges. I don't know how I just changed the light.
There you are. We couldn't see you.
Oh. But that's one, what's one scan, it's not really necessary, but sometimes if you're wondering why you have that done, it may be because you've had a previous resection in the past, and we want to be able to get a better assessment of how your body functions, both with blood supply and with acid. The last thing is cardiac clearance. So some of you are very young, and so you may not even get an EKG. Some of you have been on this planet a little bit longer, but are completely healthy, and wonder why you're getting an EKG or someone's asking you to do a stress test. And that will all be based on our discussion with you about how well you're able to function at baseline. Have you had any other maybe symptoms or things you talked about with your primary care doctor that become red flags for us that could perhaps affect your ability to be able to sustain the stress of surgery or your recovery afterwards, the likelihood that you could have challenges in terms of the stress that surgery puts on everybody's heart. And we'll talk a little bit more about that at the end when we talk about maybe challenges that some people can have in the recovery process. Consent. People wonder why I even put this up here in terms of the consent process. Part of it is that people come from various backgrounds in terms of what they're concerned about and what the consent form actually means. In the process, it's a permission slip, basically, and it's not kind of signing off your life or signing off the discussion. And some people feel like once they sign the consent form, the train has left the station and they can't actually, they've lost all control over their care or what happens. And I really want to reassure people that that is actually just the beginning of a discussion. It kind of see it as something that opens the door. And it's something where that provides you an opportunity to raise your concerns. And I really want to, what are you afraid of? What are the complications that you're most concerned about? And it allows us as surgeons to make sure that we can address what we think for you as a specific individual are more likely risks, less likely risks, and also to be able to dispel some of your concerns about maybe there's some things you're concerned about that are not an issue for your specific surgery. So that's the reason why, rather than just saying, doc, don't scare me, I'll just sign the form, don't do that. But on the other hand, don't hesitate to talk with us about what you're worried about or concerned. Let the consent process be part of your discussion. Anesthetic technique, I really wanted to begin to talk about this because some of you have had resection either for belly cases or in other parts of your body. And the anesthetic technique, if you have lesions in your lungs, it's a little bit different. When you go to sleep, we actually put in a very special kind of breathing tube, one that will allow us to ventilate or just deliver air to one lung, the lung that we're not operating on, so that we can actually deflate the lung that we're operating on and be able to work, be able to see what we need to see, be able to move that lung around without it being basically a big balloon in our face. Some patients actually wake up with a very scratchy throat afterwards. Sometimes they end up coughing and they see blood streaked mucus when they cough, and they're really concerned that something terrible has happened, or if they continue to cough, that they're going to rip their stitches or something terrible is going to happen. A lot of times that's just the scratchiness because these tubes are bigger than the usual breathing tube that we place. And so sometimes people can have irritations. Sometimes people have a very scratchy throat, sore throat, crackly voice. And those things get better. It usually takes a few days. And those are things that maybe people don't think about. When you go to see your preoperative testing nurse in the anesthesia preoperative testing center, sometimes it just gets glossed over as you're going to go to sleep, you're going to get a breathing tube. That should be fine. But these are the things that I find that when I round on patients, those are their concerns, because that's what they see, trying to cough and deep breathe in the recovery process. One of the other things that I like to let people know is that, once again, everybody's experience in the operating room is a little bit different. We'll kind of go over some of the surgical approaches and why some people have much more invasive devices and some people have less. And that has to do with how extensive the surgical resection may be, and also how frail or fragile we feel that your physiology is and how well we need to monitor you while you're asleep, and also afterwards while you're recovering. That may include having an arterial line, which is a special IV that goes in one of your arteries, usually in the wrist. It can be uncomfortable, and sometimes we place it after you go to sleep. If we're really worried about monitoring you and you going to sleep safely, sometimes it's placed before you go to sleep, and it can be uncomfortable for people. Sometimes people will end up with a central line, oftentimes in their neck or in the upper part of their chest. It's a special IV that allows us to be able to give you medicines without kind of hurting those veins that are smaller in your arms. So people wake up with those and they wonder how they got there or if they're going to have them forever. A lot of times people are afraid to turn their neck because they're afraid they're going to pull the IV out of their neck. You won't. It's a pretty good sized IV and you can't hurt yourself. Try to make it fail safe. And then the last thing, and probably one of the most important things, and this will be talked about in the pain control part of this conference, but I just want to touch on it briefly here, which is a thoracic epidural. Some patients wonder why they don't get a thoracic epidural, and some people wonder why they do, especially if they have a less invasive incision approach, meaning the VATS procedure versus an open thoracotomy. And part of that is a thoracic epidural, and some of you who have either had children and have had epidurals for childbirth or been with family members who've had them placed for childbirth, they're just the same approach. It lives outside of the kind of the lining of the spinal cord, and it sits there and it bathes the nerves as it exits the spinal cord to help give you good pain control. And the great thing about it is that it shouldn't make you nauseated, it shouldn't make you sick, it shouldn't make your bowels fall asleep. The downside is that it makes your blood pressure a little bit lower. And if you're someone who already lives with low blood pressure or has other medical problems, it makes it so that a low blood pressure isn't a good thing for you. We have to be very thoughtful about how we manage your perioperative pain. And adjusting that epidural can be important. Some people can get a lot of itching, and some people can even end up with headaches if the epidural ends up being placed too deeply. We have a wonderful perioperative pain service here. They're here 24 hours a day. And at many centers, they're here 24 hours a day, so we can adjust those pain medications, we can adjust the epidural. But the great thing about having an epidural is that whether you have small incisions or big incisions, and we'll talk a little bit about the areas that can cause irritation, it allows you to cough, deep breathe, and allows you to do the things that as a patient to allow you to participate in recovery postoperatively with less need for narcotics. And then what we do is as you kind of begin to get up, walk around, do more things, we'll add the pain pills to it, and that way you have a nicer transition to having the epidural removed. Some people have panic attacks wondering, oh no, we're going to take out the epidural, now we're going to have horrible pain, we're going to go home and have horrible pain. But most people do really well, and we'll talk you through it. And I just wanted to give you guys a picture. This is one picture which kind of helps you understand why the breathing tube is a little bit different, it's a little bit bigger. Most breathing tubes end right here. This breathing tube will go all the way down to one side and allow us to only give air to this lung, and this whole lung can just collapse. And some people say, well, how can I breathe and how can I function only on one lung? It's actually pretty amazing. You don't need that much lung tissue in order to provide adequate ventilation to your whole body. So let's talk about some of the things that can happen during a surgical approach. And sometimes people have two stages in approach to their surgery, and some people have one. These are some terms that I want to throw out there, especially if you all have heard that you needed to have a mediastinoscopy or you needed to have a bronchoscopy before you had your big surgery. A bronchoscopy is similar to if anyone's ever had a colonoscopy or an EGD. It's the same kind of camera, and it's the same kind of instrument, just smaller and designed for the airway. Sometimes we'll have people come in, even if they've had a bronchoscopy by their pulmonologist, maybe at another institution. When they come to see us, either way, you'll probably end up with a bronchoscopy either at the time of your surgery or maybe as a secondary evaluation if you've had interval therapy. And it's just we usually let you go completely to sleep when we do them. We do these in the operating room. And it's just a camera that goes straight down your airways. We take a look. The great thing about those cameras is they have side ports, so if there's something that we need to take tissue, to diagnose, we can actually biopsy directly through the camera. And oftentimes, if we're able to, if the equipment works properly, you can take pictures, and after we're done, we can actually show you your own airways. And if your lesion actually is pushing out into the airway, we can kind of show you the before and after. Usually at the end of any sort of lung resection, if we end up doing any sort of reconstruction, oftentimes we, for ourselves, will also document, especially if patients are coming from far away, and we want to communicate with their pulmonologist, perhaps with their local surgeons that might be doing their follow-up care far away, so they can see what the anastomosis look like. Mediastinoscopy, big word, sounds really fancy and very scary. It's actually a very small incision. What we do is it's a way for us to stage the middle part of your chest where all your lymph nodes basically live. Some patients, this is not a necessary step, but for others, if your PET scan lights up and the lymph nodes that are up high seem to be active and they may have disease, this may be something that we decide or recommend to have done before going on to a larger lung resection. It's a small incision, usually just above kind of the little notch at the top of your sternum, and people usually go home the same day. Every once in a while, people need to stay overnight, but it doesn't go into your lungs, it doesn't go anywhere else, and so you just have a little tiny incision, you can go home and that's fine. And it allows us to get whole lymph nodes for adequate staging, not just little pieces or needle aspiration. And then finally, the surgical resection. So VATS, or video-assisted thoracoscopic surgery, or thoracotomy. And that latter approach, meaning just a classic open approach, can have many different flavors. And so some people wake up with different incisions and they wonder if they've had a thoracotomy or if they've had a VATS or if they've had a combination of both. We'll kind of go over those things. Okay, so as I said, VATS is a video-assisted thoracic surgery. Many people say, well, this is minimally invasive. It's like getting my gallbladder out. It's like, it's just I got little tiny incisions, and so I should feel great, and I should get better quick, and I should go home, and it should be like I've never had surgery. Well, those of you who've had this know that the one thing I want everyone to walk out of here understanding is that no matter what your incision looks like, you get the same surgery on the inside. And guess what? Your body only knows what surgery you had. It doesn't care about your incisions. So some people end up being very frustrated when they've had a VATS surgery that they're not recovering as fast as they would expect. And they feel very discouraged as though there's something wrong with them or something went wrong with the surgery. And they have to kind of step back and say, no. You had a whole lobe of your lung removed. It's going to take you a while to recover. It's going to take you a while to feel better. You're still going to feel sluggish. You're still going to have ups and downs. You may still have soreness at your chest tube site. These are all very normal and expected courses of recovery because you still have had big surgery. And if you don't remember anything else that I've said today, please remember that. Sometimes you'll have three small incisions. Sometimes you'll have four. It depends upon how you're built, what we're able to see, and whether or not we need any extra instrumentation. Generally here, we end up doing the largest of those incisions where we remove the lung tissue. Ends up being about maybe a 3-inch incision. It's usually up and down, and I'll show you a picture of kind of the schematic of what I would expect your incisions to be. One of the things that I want to bring forward, particularly for the women who have these incisions, one of the things that I found pretty commonly, both in the hospital and also seeing people in clinic, is that unfortunately where we put these incisions, if you have an underwire, that's exactly where one of those incisions is going to be. And no one ever seems to tell women this, either before surgery or after surgery. And it's really important. And so some women, the fact that they end up wearing camisoles for maybe even up to 6 months afterwards, because you can still have a lot of tenderness over that incision site, even if you're not having pain. And I usually tell women, you can put a little maxi pad right where your underwire is if you really need that support. But there are things that I really encourage you as you all talk to each other and as you guys provide support, the ways that you come up with to manage your incisions at home are very helpful to other patients. I think being able to share your stories both with great healing experiences and maybe not so great healing experiences and how you've managed that is really important to patients feeling encouraged and also feeling like they're not alone in their recovery process. A lot of times we think that you're going to just have a small incision, you can put a Band-Aid on it, and you should be able to go on with your life. And I can't tell you how many patients who we've seen either from other places or from our own institution who they have a tiny incision, but it's really painful for them. And kind of working through how we're going to manage that pain and that discomfort, and part of that is the way each person heals. And we'll talk about why some places may be more painful than others. Then there's a standard thoracotomy. It's a single incision. It's usually larger. It can be anywhere from 4 inches to maybe as big as 8 inches, depending upon what kind of exposure we need and what kind of resection we plan. It can be vertical or the classic, what we call posterior lateral thoracotomy, which can be about 8 inches, and it's more towards the back between kind of right there in the armpit going all the way back to kind of the shoulder blade. Usually what we do is we try to save any of the big muscles. So if you bring your arm forward, you can feel that big muscle, which I'll show you a picture of in a second. We try to move those muscles aside. In the past, if any of you had this resection done perhaps 15 or 20 years ago, classically we would just divide that big muscle, and some people would have some discomfort. Regardless of what we do have to make space in those ribs. The maker didn't design us to have our ribs spread. We weren't made like Gumby, and it's not really designed to stretch more than a certain amount. And so in order for us to see, get our hands in there, and do what we need to do, we need to spread those ribs. It's usually only about 3 or 4 inches in terms of the spread, but that can be pretty significant in terms of the discomfort. Everyone's different. Some people's bones are very elastic and they can handle that spread. We don't have to do anything, and those muscles relax and retract and people do fine. But people who either have more brittle bones, and that can be at any age, or people who are very muscular, and so trying to get that spread, those muscles above and below don't permit us to be able to mobilize as well as we like. Every once in a while, we have to resect a small section of a rib in the incision, and no, we do not put it back. That's one of the questions that we get. Question is, does that affect the way that my lungs function and the way that I breathe? Does that mean that I'm going to have more pain? The answer is no. You won't notice the difference. That's just what I was talking about, the small little half-inch segment of the rib. And it's usually removed almost all the way back towards the back. It's not a big section that's missing from the side or from the front. And that's the reason why it doesn't make a whole lot of difference, and you won't have a divot, on the side of your chest from the moment. This is a schematic of kind of where those incisions are. So when you're looking at yourself afterwards, or if your family's looking at your incisions, you're wondering where are the holes going to be. And this just is a good way to kind of look at them. So here is the incision that will usually be the largest, and that's closest up to the armpit, and that's usually where we take out any of the lung tissue that we have to resect. You will usually have a chest tube, and that chest tube will either come out here or here, depending upon what makes the most sense. And so when you wake up, you'll have a drainage tube, and I'll explain to you kind of where that lives, why it's uncomfortable, and why you have pain, even if you have an epidural. Now, if we do a classic open incision, as I talked about, this vertical thoracotomy here, or axillary thoracotomy, is usually in about the same area, and it's usually up and down, and like I said, it's exactly where your underwire ends if you're a woman who wears an underwire bra, and it can be really uncomfortable once you start trying to figure out when you can wear the support device. But in general, it's pretty hidden, and so some people love it because they can still wear bikinis, they don't have to worry, or short shirts, men who like to wear tank tops and exercise, it doesn't become a conversation piece because oftentimes it's hidden by classic undergarments. From a cosmetic standpoint. The posterior lateral thoracotomy usually lets people know that you've had chest surgery, and it usually lets you know that you've had chest surgery as well. And it can be of various lengths. It can be as short as 4 centimeters if that's all we need. It can be as long as 8 or 12 centimeters. In the past, if you had this done by surgeons who maybe trained 30 years ago, it may extend all the way from way back behind your shoulder blade, and they come all the way around to the front and encompass almost half of your chest. And that just depends on what's necessary in order to be able to see and also to resect easily and to make sure that we give you the best oncologic resection. And that's one thing that I want everyone to understand, what's necessary in order to make sure that we can remove the lesion. Our concern is, our concern is you and your survival. We can close your skin, and we can do our best to give you the best healing as possible, but we want you to live the best quality of life and cancer-free, and that is our job as surgeons. Okay, so let's talk about the differences, and like I said, you can take this with a grain of salt because your experience is your experience, and I really want to enforce that. So VATS versus the standard approach, there is less pain, maybe because there's less rib spreading. But anytime we enter the chest, you have to go in between the ribs. And underneath each rib, there's a blood vessel. And there are two blood vessels, so a vein and an artery and a nerve. Those nerves are very sensitive. So even if you don't divide it, it having been bumped by instruments or being moved, nerves are not very forgiving structures. They let you know they've been touched, and they hold a grudge. And they can hold a grudge for weeks or longer. And we have to deal with that. The next question is one of recovery, and which do you recover faster from? One of the things is that sometimes people are in the hospital longer because they've had a larger resection, even if they still had a VATS procedure, so the recovery actually may be longer. If you come in for something like a wedge resection, which means a very small piece of lung is removed, chest tube is removed the next morning, you go home that afternoon, you can expect your recovery to probably be almost back to baseline within 2 to 4 weeks. And so some people say, wow, if I go home in 36 hours from my surgery, why should I still be feeling lousy a month later? Well, it's because you've still had surgery and your body still needs to heal. And for some patients, it can take even longer. And we'll kind of look at that. Hospital stay. Once again, I think the best rule of thumb is to ask your surgeon, how difficult was the case and how long, what kind of resection was ultimately done in terms of gauging your expectations and your family's expectations for how long you're going to be in the hospital. Like I said, some of our VATS surgeries, patients are only in the hospital for as little as 3 days. But for some of our lobectomies, our bilobectomies, our pneumonectomies, some patients are in the hospital 5 to 7 days, sometimes longer if they've had challenges in the recovery process. And we like to talk to people as we're going through. A lot of people are trying to make plans in terms of hotels, telling family when they can take off from work and things like that. I usually tell patients, don't call out the troops until that chest tube comes out in terms of planning for going home. Because that chest tube can be very finicky and it can stay in 3 or 4 days longer than we expect, and you're constantly telling somebody, I'm gonna go home tomorrow, I'm gonna go home tomorrow, and then on rounds in the morning it changes. And then finally, cosmesis. There are two things that kind of affect what you can expect in terms of how you're gonna heal. Some people ask about, you know, vitamin D, you know, how well, you know, am I gonna have dissolvable stitches? Am I gonna have stitches on the outside? Am I gonna have staples? All of our patients have dissolvable stitches that are underneath the skin. However, some of those stitches, depending upon how thin your skin is, or just how your body reacts to having a foreign body, sometimes people notice a little nubbin that kind of pushes its way out maybe 3 weeks later, and they're worried that if they pull that little stitch, are they going to completely unravel? No, you're not going to come apart, I promise you. But sometimes your body doesn't break down that dissolvable suture as quickly as your body decides to heal. And it's not really a big problem. Oftentimes when we see you in the office, we'll just pull it out ourselves. But cosmesis, some people are better healers than others. Some people can have large incisions, and then by the time they're done, they just heal with a very thin line. Other people do suffer from keloid. Other people do suffer from having the way that their body chooses to heal and the amount of kind of induration and scar that remodels can give them some contour changes, especially if you're a very slender person, depending upon how big your incision is and where it needed to be situated in order to do your surgery. So I really like to tell people to both be forgiving of themselves, but also to understand that this is a dynamic process. The incision or the scar that you leave the hospital with will continue to remodel and change over weeks to months, and so especially if you end up with a thoracotomy incision, you need to realize that feeling a ridge underneath that incision is not uncommon. It will not be permanent. It will start to soften up, but there are some people that just the way that they form scar will always be able to feel something underneath that skin incision for the rest of their lives, and that's part of how they scar. The other thing, like I said, we talked about patient factors and oncologic resection. One of the things that I like to let people know is that even if we consent you for a video-assisted approach, if we find in the operating room that using the camera and the small tools are not safe to be able to get the tumor out, if we think that it is better for you to have a thoracotomy, we are not going to go out and talk to your family, we are not going to wake you up, we are not going to stop the surgery, we are going to do what is going to be safest for you. And we will change to what we call an open technique. We'll make an incision larger so that we can see and we can take care of what you came there for, which is getting that tumor out. There are rare occurrences, less common when dealing with carcinoid, because we have great CT scans and imaging, it's very rare that we encounter a tumor or a lesion that we expect to go to surgery for that we find that we cannot resect. However, that is not an impossibility, especially with larger, bulky tumors that are situated towards the center part of the lung. And there are times, unfortunately, where we do have to have those conversations with patients where we say, you know what, we found some things that weren't expected. We found some things that we didn't think were going to be safe, or we knew, based on your preoperative testing, that you would not be able to tolerate the level of resection that was necessary in order to take out all the tumor. It is not okay to just take out part of the tumor and leave some behind. We know that we cannot safely give you what we call an R0 resection, meaning no gross tumor left behind, and leave you functional at the end, then surgeons will say, you know, we couldn't do the resection. And that is the reason why. And that's why we do what we do. That's why we have to put our hands in your chest, touch and feel, because that's the ultimate diagnostic procedure. And it's unfortunate when we have to be at that position. It's rare. So let's talk about the anatomy. So we talked about the incisions, we talked about our approach. So let's look at the chest wall, kind of where are these things in relationship to muscles that we all see and understand. How is this related to the ribs, the blood vessels and nerves that we talked about? And finally, this elusive thing that's the pleura, which I think is the bane of every thoracic patient's experience. It's painful. And I try to explain to people what it is, but it hurts more than the skin incision. It hurts more than the chest tube. And then next we'll look at a picture that just looks at the lungs, the fact that the left lung is different than the right lung. There is no middle lobe in the left lung. The heart kind of made things a little bit funky. The left lung has an upper lobe and a lower lobe, and it has this little kind of tongue that sticks out, which is kind of like a fake middle lobe that's attached to the upper lobe, which is called the lingula. And so if someone says you have a lingular lesion, that's where it's located, and I'll show you a picture of that. And the right lung has three classic lobes and two fissures. And once again, you take this with a grain of salt. Everyone is, you develop uniquely. It's almost like a fingerprint. Everyone's lungs are different. Not in terms of grossly different, but where the fissures are located, how big the upper lobe, lower lobe, or middle lobes are unique to each patient. And so what you expect in terms of how well you will breathe, what your chest x-ray will look like when you've recovered, whether or not you'll have a space or not, those are things that are unique to you, and that's part of the discussion with your surgeon. Let's look at some pictures. So I like this picture because it's very simple. Everybody knows what the pec is. This is the deltoid, that's your shoulder. This is that muscle that you can only see on, like, I don't know, swimmers, Olympic swimmers, that serratus muscle. I don't have it. But
I have
them. Oh, yeah.
So those of us lowly folks that just have vestigial serratus, we can't ever see them. And then this is this big muscle, the latissimus. And that is something that oftentimes we're able to just push aside. We don't have to divide it. But in the past, this is where the old-fashioned thoracotomy incision used to come up around. So this is our scapula. It used to come from here all the way around to the front here. It sounds really big, but it's not that bad. Now, this is a picture that I think will really help you guys understand kind of what you're dealing with from a pain standpoint. And this is actually a look from the inside with the lungs removed, the heart removed, and you can kind of see this beautiful diagram of underneath every rib, you have two blood vessels and a nerve that run underneath every rib, and you've got these muscles that run up and down in between. We have to divide those muscles. There's no kind of muscle-free zone that we can go through. So a lot of people end up having muscular soreness and pain even after everything else has gone on. And oftentimes the chest tubes that we place will actually go in between those rib spaces here and run up along, and that's why you have some discomfort. Inside here, they've removed the pleura, which lines the inside of your chest wall, and I usually tell every patient, if you actually run your tongue on the inside of your cheek, that smooth lining is exactly the same as the lining on the inside of your chest, and it's exactly the same as the lining over your lung. And that's what allows your lung to move smoothly. That's also full of nerves. And so when we place our chest tube, that pain that you have in the back of your shoulder, or sometimes going up to your neck, is from that chest tube rubbing along that pleura. And there's no medicine that we can use to make that totally deaden. But we get the chest tube out and it goes away. All right, so I'm gonna speed up. We've kind of talked about the pulmonary arteries, pulmonary veins, the bronchi, the lymph nodes, the bronchial arteries, and the lung tissue. Those are all the things that we have to cut through in order to remove a section of lung tissue. And we have to think about that. So just from an anatomic standpoint, pulmonary arteries actually carry blue blood, pulmonary veins carry oxygen-rich blood, the bronchi are your airways, the lymph nodes are actually, I kind of consider them as the sewage system, they take away all the bad stuff. And then the bronchial arteries are these little tiny arteries that actually supply just the airways, and then your lung tissue does the gas exchange. So this is just a very quick schematic to kind of let you know where all those blood vessels live. And then this is an even blurrier schematic, but it's actually good that it's blurry because it's very busy, and it actually is a very good example of how busy things can be in your chest when we're operating. And then lastly, this schematic actually lets you know where most of the lymph nodes live. So when people talk about either a mediastinoscopy or a lymph node resection, whenever we do surgery, we have to make sure that we have a certain amount of these lymph nodes removed, so for a pathologic specimen whenever we do surgery. So let's talk about the surgical approach. So we have wedge resection, which just means a removal of a section of lung. It's non-anatomic. A segmentectomy removes the smallest anatomic section of lung. A lobectomy means removing one of those lobes. A bilobectomy can only happen on the right side, which removes two lobes. And a pneumonectomy means that we've removed an entire lung from that side of the chest. So this is a great picture that you guys can just see exactly what that means from an anatomic standpoint, looking at the right lung. And so here we go for wedge, segmentectomy, lobectomy, and pneumonectomy. So let's talk, we talked a little bit about the postoperative care. Rarely do our patients ever have to go to the intensive care unit. It's only if they require special medicines or special monitoring that they have to stay there, or if they have to keep the breathing tube in, which is pretty rare. The chest tubes usually remain in until they meet criteria for drainage or for air leak, and the epidural usually remains in while the chest tube is in place. This is one thing that I wanted to talk about, which is pulmonary toilet, and it's really important for patients both preoperatively, perioperatively, and postoperatively when you go home. Walking is your best friend. It's the last thing you want to do, but it's actually the easiest way for your body to recover and for your lungs to function. You need for gravity to help you. So even though we give you an incentive spirometer that gives you a chance to be able to see how much your lungs are able to bring in and blow out, walking actually allows gravity to drop your diaphragms and allow you to breathe in the most physiologic way. And lastly, respiratory therapy is a big part of our care here. They will give you bronchodilators, they'll give you therapy, and while you're here in the hospital, to help you kind of bring up those secretions, open up those airways as you're recovering from surgery. Like I said, the average hospital stay is about 4 to 7 days. Outpatient recovery, we tell people 4 to 6 weeks, but everybody's different. Some people can feel like $1 million 6 weeks after surgery. Some folks, 2 months, 3 months after surgery, they're still feeling like they're not back to their baseline. Some people still have some windedness. They feel like their exercise tolerance is still very low. Oftentimes, it's not necessarily. If you do a pulmonary function test, their pulmonary function tests may still be normal, but even something as simple as a week stay in the hospital, nobody realizes how deconditioned you can become. That's the reason why, as I go on to our, this is just, we'll skip that. We'll skip the complications because we've already talked about that. But in summary, I really, like I said before, I really wanted you guys to understand that your surgery is tailored to you. It's very important for you to have ongoing conversations with your surgical team. To be able to understand why a surgery was recommended, perhaps why an intraoperative decision was made, and what the changes or findings were that kind of guided that decision, and what you should expect in terms of recovery based on those decisions and findings in the operating room. Oftentimes those are based on your patient, you as an individual, your characteristics, your anatomy, and also where you are in terms of progression of disease, in terms of what we think is reasonable. Regardless of the incision, your surgery is the same. Inside. And also, recovery is significantly improved by preoperative and postoperative activity. When we were children, we were told when you're sick, have soup and ginger ale and don't get out of bed until you feel better. Actually, it's exactly the opposite. The more walking you do as you're anticipating going into the hospital for surgery, the better your recovery is going to be, the better your recovery is going to be afterwards. You must walk. Walking will save your life. It'll keep you from getting pneumonias, it'll keep you from getting infections, and it actually will help you feel better and your lungs to function better, not only for the short term, but as you kind of head towards the next phase of your treatment. Okay, thank you for your attention.